So it could be that we're an island and because of that we have an insular attitude, or perhaps we're just short-sighted and thoroughly stubborn in clinging on to all that is British, as Khalid Aziz has also shrewdly observed.
You know, Sarah, a favourite word amongst Eurocrats is harmonisation. They'd like to see conformity right across the board in EEC countries. The trouble is, what to conform to? Each country has its own strong views on what should and shouldn't be, and that's led to some curious anomalies. For example, when is a cauliflower not a cauliflower? Answer, when it hasn't got two green leaves and isn't a certain size. Of course, lawns the length and breadth of Europe have to be kept neatly trimmed, but beware. Mower, make sure it makes no more than the EEC standard level of noise. That's better. But if you think you'd perhaps like to have a more natural method of keeping the grass down, take care too, because for EEC purposes, goats are classed as sheep. Haven't harmonised that bit though. If you want to do a bit of planting, mind out where you put your hyacinth bulbs. The EEC has decided that hyacinths are in fact vegetables. But you can never accuse the EEC of being heartless. They will listen to any proposal that might make us, as Europeans, more humane. The latest suggestion comes from a French... Thank you, goats. French MEP Bernard Antony, who has prized the lid off the seamier side of British shellfish eating. He insists that the way we open our oysters is unnecessarily cruel. Naturally, he feels we should learn the correct method from his countrymen, who, of course, can do no wrong. The Germans are up in arms about what we call sausages. Theirs, they say, are the only true sausages because they contain more meat and less fat and filler. And finally, ice cream. Not according to the Italians, who perhaps with some justification say they know what ice cream really is. In their view, the stuff churned out by British manufacturers ought not to be called ice cream, but something like non-milk fat dessert. Whisper it quietly, though. Walls have ears.
Oh, walls have ears. Yeah, they got it. Thank you, Khalid, very nice. So today, with the help of two MEPs, a pro-European Kenneth Williams here, and a brace or two of Europe watchers, let's see if we'll ever be European first and British second. We have an audience full of French, British, of course, German, Spaniards, Italians, Greeks, Venezuelans. But let me first of all go to a Brit. Can you think that you would be British second or European first? What about you, madam?
As far as I'm concerned, we should call this show No EEC Please, We're British. I think that sums it all up. Just like non-stick frying pans, which are meant to be a great boon, they simply don't work and the market doesn't work, and I think we should realise it and say, nice try, super idea, doesn't work. I mean, did you realise that they pay farmers subsidies to grow stuff that we can't possibly need?
I don't think you'd feel European, do you?
No.
But then you are South African.
I am.
All right, let's go to some more Brits. What about you? European or British first?
British first and a strong European second. I should be. I have a German father and an English mother, but I'm very committed to the European ideal.
Lovely. You'll tell us perhaps later on why. Let's ask some people up here. What about you?
I am German, but I swing either way.
Very tactful remark there. What about you?
Well, I'm European first and British second. A strong British second, but if we're in the common market and we agree with it as I do, then I believe we should gear ourselves towards the European community.
Thank you. There were some mutterings and people shaking their heads. Anyone who feels very strongly they're British first and a European second. Why is that?
Well, I was British born and bred and I'm proud of this country and I think we could do well on our own. We don't need to be in the EEC.
We don't need it. What about this gentleman here?
As far as I'm concerned, the EEC just seems to be whittling away the identity of Britain. As far as money, as far as... OK, so it was farthings, halfpennies, shillings, pennies, ridiculous. It was Britain. It was an identity which is being eked away. Not only by Europe, of course, but by America as well.
Well, let's turn to some of our foreigners. It's an awful way to say it, isn't it? This gentleman here, you look as if you want to say, are you European or... You're French, aren't you?
Yes, I'm
French. First?
There's no contradiction between being French, Italian, German, British and European. I mean, you can be both. And in the French school in London, we just give the example of that mixing of people, that melting pot of pupils coming from all over the world and from Europe, and I think everybody gets the better and enriches each other. We enrich each other through being together.
Marvellous speech. I don't know what you're at a language school for. You're excellent. Let's join our MEPs now. David Curry, first of all, European or British first?
I'm a European in order to be a better Briton. My grandfather could go out and govern an empire, and that's not there. My parents lived through those great days of 1940 when the English world stood alone, and I haven't had that experience. The most exciting thing happening that I can be part of and do something about is the creation of Europe, and I'm doing it not because I want to abandon being British, because I think that Britain's future is very much in Europe.
Bob Crowe?
Well, I'm a European, as everybody is here, but Europe doesn't mean 10 inward-looking countries of the common market. It means the whole of the continent. And if our friend here is right about nations enriching each other, why should we stick at the common market? Why should we be members of the common market for this, quote, Europe? And, I mean, this is part of the
You're
propaganda.
You're an MEP. What are you saying? Why should we be?
Well, because I stood on the Labour Party programme very clearly in criticism of the common market, and I believe that we should withdraw from the common market because I think it's economically done us damage.
But why are you an MEP, then?
Well, because I think that as long as we're members of the common market, we have to have a voice in the common market to stop them doing more damage. And I certainly try and do that. But I think that our position lies outside the common market, like Sweden, Austria, Norway, for example.
So are you
They are part of Europe. And Sweden, for instance, has a positive balance of payments with the common market. It won't cut us off from trade. We can negotiate with the common market, good trading arrangements, but we won't be subject to this plethora of harmonisation and uniformity. And they only do that. They only, for example, have lawnmower levels because if we make noisier lawnmowers in the United Kingdom, they have less silencing and therefore cheaper. And in the interest of this absurd huge market, they want to harmonise everything.
OK,
and
we'll come back to harmonisation in just a second.
Speeches in the European Parliament, which is why we take no notice of him.
He's obviously got a lot of support. Let us ask the archetypal British gent, Kenneth Williams. What are you, sir?
Well, I'm not archetypal British gent. I'm Welsh, in actual fact. You see, Cymru sees,
Cymru
sees,
Cymru
and Bith. No, I don't think at all that anyone who is progressive would be anything but European-minded. I was active in the campaign when the referendum was on, should we go in or shouldn't we, and I was saying we should, and I happen to think that my little effort was well rewarded when the answer was yes, affirmative, wasn't it? And I don't think, contrary to what you say, that it's an inward-looking little group. I think one of the examples of the outward-looking nature of it is that the European Community provided 35% of aid to the underdeveloped countries, and you compare that percentage with America, which is about 16, and with somebody like Russia, which is about 5, you see it's far from inward-looking.
Thank you, Kenneth. Bob, let's take up your point. You were talking about this harmonisation that Khalid was talking about. Everyone should be the same. Who feels strongly about that? Gentleman in the... Oh, my goodness, what a suit, sir.
Thank you. I really don't know why Bob Crier isn't more keen on Europe. It's doing all the same sort of stupid socialist things that that we have abandoned in this country since electing two Conservative governments, or electing the Conservative government two times.
What do you object about, though, in the harmonisation, that we should all be the same?
No, I don't object to that. Well, this is plain politicking on the part of the Labour Party, obviously. If the subsidies to jobs and the aid to industry that comes back from the European Community were stopped, the Labour Party would be the first people to scream and shout about it.
Thank you. I think you're doing a little bit of politicking as well. Let's just... I want to see what people feel about us all being the same. The lady over here.
Sarah, if we're supposed to be harmonising, why don't they make our old-age pensioners up to what the other countries get? We get a lot less.
Yeah.
I know I've got both my mother and mother-in-law who find it very hard to live, same as all the other pensioners here. Why don't they get the same? They get an awful lot abroad.
Good point.
Can I just sort of say about politics? Let's forget the politics. I think that this basic thing is getting to know the people. It's the ordinary ground people who are the basic. I think these politicians ought to come back to us. I represent Twinning. And twinning.
Twin-towning.
Twin-towning, yes. And I think that it's we that put you in. Let's forget about the politics a bit and not get so itty-bitty about all these things.
You're also saying, in a way, aren't you, that we're very insular. We're sitting there protecting, as I say, our red phone boxes,
yes,
our passports,
yes,
the Channel Tunnel.
It's the people that count. And I think that Euro MPs ought to think, well, it's twinning and it's us ground people who actually put you in that Euro Parliament. And the more that the Euro MPs come to us and tell us what they're doing, I mean, this is it.
Thank you. Bob Crier, I think even Edward Heath has said, I say even Edward Heath because obviously he's very pro-Europe and took us in, but he has accused some MEPs of actually trying to wreck the European Parliament. Now, I don't quite understand why you're in it and how you could do your job if you are.
Well, I'm in it because I was elected on a manifesto which was for withdrawal of the United Kingdom from the common market. I'm there, as I made clear, to raise my voice on behalf of my electorate and on behalf of saner policies. I mean, quite obviously, it's a grey area. You can't sort of say, well, we're having nothing to do with it. We're in the common market. I hope we'll get out, but as long as we're in the common market, it seems to me we've got to have a voice inside there, because the Assembly is only a consultative assembly, but obviously when that opinion is sought, we've got to try and limit the harmonisation, limit the damage. And, for example, when people wanted to raise the question of the starving people in Ethiopia contrasting with the bulging wheat warehouses of the common market, and that doesn't seem to be very close to what people term the European ideal, they wrote to me, and a lot of members of the British Labour Group raised this in the Assembly to try and push the commissioners into doing something. They did it very badly and slowly, but at least we pushed them in the right direction.
Thank you. Is the PR wrong, David, in that harmonisation, as we've seen about the hyacinth bulbs and the skimmed milk and the food mountains being burnt to keep prices up? We don't understand that.
If politicians blame PR, it's because they've been bad politicians. I don't believe in blaming PR. But look at harmonisation. Nobody wants Europe to be the same. Do you really think that the French plan to see themselves like everybody else? My wife is French. She still remains jolly French, though she's been married to me for 15 years.
They don't want our lamb, though, do they?
That's the same right across the common market. My wife buys New Zealand lamb, as a matter of fact, if you really want to know. The idea is to enable us to trade. Most harmonisation is a form of consumer protection. It's so that we can buy German sausages if we want it, and they can buy our whiskey or our products, so that you can actually create that market which creates jobs. Now, Bob Cryer says he was elected there for a British voice. Well, we need a British voice, and I actually think we need a British voice from the Conservative, from Labour, and from the other parties as well. But it's got to be a reasonable, civilised, intelligent, constructive voice.
And
what Bob Cryer and his people do in the European Parliament is the equivalent of what Manchester United football supporters do when they play away matches. It's
David.
Pure, unadulterated... It is pure, unadulterated thuggery, which damages their interests, which I don't care a damn about, but it damages British interests, which I care a lot about.
I totally take your point, but what people read in the papers, what people read in the papers are things like cruelty to mollusks and hyacinth bulbing
vegetables. You've been taken for a glorious ride, and they fell for it hook, line and sinker. I've got his press release down here of the Labour Group.
Explain it to us. Cruelty to mollusks.
Because every single daft issue you can imagine, the Labour Group press officer comes up with a marvellous release. Do you remember renaming Waterloo Station? Nobody ever said it. It was pure, inventive, malicious fiction from the Labour Group.
That is their whole aim.
That is their idea of being constructive.
I take your point. Do we want harmonisation? A lot of people have mentioned food. Bill Roberts.
I think it's true. I don't know if it's PR or not, that some of these mad ideas, like whatever it was, tattooing oysters or something, these ideas that seem to come out straight out of a Carry On film, do get a lot of publicity.
Sorry, Kenneth, about that.
But they tend to divert attention from the really useful things that Europe's doing. Getting lead out of petrol, for example. What I'd say on those kind of issues, though, is it's a matter of priorities. There are major priorities that Europe could address. For example, what's called product liability, making it easier for the parents of drug-damaged children to get redress from drug companies. Now, that's the kind of thing that Europe should be concentrating on to protect its citizens.
Thank you. Bob, let me just ask you, what good has come out of Europe for us while we've been in?
Well, I can't think of anything, even though I searched my mind. I mean, somebody over there said, for example, that a lot of money comes into this country, and you said that 200 and odd million pounds was given in grants a few days ago. In fact, there was a lot of publicity, particularly in regional papers. But since between 1979 and 1984, for example, after receiving all the grants back, we paid a net contribution of 3,000 million pounds. It costs a lot of money to be in the common market. And the deficit that we have in manufacturing trade, the things we're supposed to do very well in, is totalling in 1983 8,000 million pounds. We're getting a very bad deal out of the common market, and the sooner that we extricate ourselves whilst trading with the we're trading with both the common market and the rest of Europe. That's important. I'm not talking about being a little Englander. I'm talking about sensible trading relations which we can negotiate.
Kenneth.
Well, the trading situation with vis-à-vis us and Europe is roughly in balance in point of fact, because what we've lost on the manufacturing base section, we've gained on the oil and services base. So you can't say that we're unprofitable there. And since we joined in 72, you look at how our trade with Europe has grown. It is a dramatic growth. I mean, 72 figures approximately 3 billion. Now, the latest 83 is over 21 billion. I mean, if that isn't good news to English manufacturing and to jobs from this country, I don't know what is.
But I would put the point, and I think a lot of people feel it, what about British nationality? Is it being whittled away?
No, because idiosyncratic things will always exist within communities, just as you'll never take away the Devonian accent, no matter what people say about standard English and all that. You'll still get those things existing, and so you will in the autonomous areas in Europe. You'll never stop that. That's a cultural matter. What the EEC is about, fundamentally, we all seem to be forgetting this, it's about trade. It's a partnership in terms of trade where you get together, and our benefits from it are enormous because fundamentally we are an exporting setup.
Well, let's ask this lady. You were very anti. Do you think, Kenneth's point, that trade is what it's all about?
No, not really. I mean, who got the butter? I mean, there was butter for 42 pence when, Russians get it either free or 10 pence pound. No, the thing is, you said I was South African, and so it is, and so I feel I can talk from living half my life in one country and half in another. And you Brits don't know, or us Brits, because I'm now British, we don't know how lucky we are, because we are not insular. We never will be insular. We are an outward-going, non-parochial, and believe me, having lived in a very parochial country, I know of what I speak.
But let me ask everyone else if they agree. Do you think, let's ask some foreigners, some visitors, are we parochial? Are we island? Are we really an island-like race? Let's have the lady here.
Yeah, I think so.
We're narrow-minded?
Yeah, I think so.
In what way?
In the way that you don't want to break down the barriers which could create a real community,
a community,
open community.
Thank you. Let me ask some French people and some Germans. What about the German gentleman here? Are we very stubborn and insular, do you think?
Sorry, I don't understand your question.
don't worry. Well said, anyway. Let me ask it to some people over here. Are we insular? Are we our own worst enemies?
Yes, I would think so, yes.
Because, why?
I would say because you had a British empire, so you felt like your own. You could support yourself. So you had a mind insular because you're yourselves.
Okay. Anyone else disagree or agree?
I agree entirely. I'm Italian-born and British by marriage, and although I lived here much longer than I ever lived in Italy, I don't feel European, I feel British first. My children, who are English, feel English first. We all enjoy the European, I like the French, I like the German, I like everybody, but I think the English themselves will always consider European foreigners. And that's what I think that's against
David, whether it's got anything to do with, I mean, you know what it's like when you go on holiday, excusing the French, they don't really take much notice of you. The Italians are usually asleep and muttering, demanding, and the Germans have stolen the deck chairs. When you take that silly example and you put it in a summit conference, for example, do they like each other? The
well,
leaders?
As you say, it is a rather silly example because they don't nick the deck chairs, and I get on very well with people when I go abroad, even if you don't speak the language, with a minimum of courtesy and a little bit of effort perhaps to try and understand, and perhaps you can learn one or two words, that makes a help. And
my children are
half French, a quarter Dutch and a quarter English, and I would be really rather upset if they didn't think of themselves as being English in the first instance. That's their place where they depart from. It doesn't matter whether they like each other or not. It's as long as they recognise that they're going to work together. If you want to be a successful Briton, you've got to be a successful European to do it. That is actually helping you to be more successful. The French have been in Europe since the beginning. They managed to give the world the impression that every good idea that was ever thought of was thought of in French, by Frenchmen. But that's part of the style of doing it. And perhaps
why
what we
so
should do is
a little.
We're not apathetic. Well, you've seen your audience.
Well, we were 32%.
Half of them are passionately hostile.
Went to vote.
Because we held a European election. In France, it was national politics which was at stake. In Germany, it was national politics that was at stake. We are the only country in Europe which actually fought an election about Europe. And considering we've only been in there for half a generation, actually a third turnout is not too bad. My county council is elected with less than that, you know.
Well, in 1975, we had a referendum in which people voted massively to say yes to the common market, not to Europe, because that's 40 countries. We're talking about 10, only a minority. And after 10 years or so, people realised that it's been rumbled, that all the promises, if you remember the referendum, it was run on a slogan, jobs for the boys. There's 14 million people unemployed in the common market. There's these huge stockpiles of food. They don't know what to give to do with them. And if the Soviet Union ever invade, which I don't believe they're going to, they'll march on common market food because, as our friend there said, they get it cheaply. It's an absurd system. You can't reform the common agricultural policy. There are too many vested interests, farming interests in the common market, who want that revenue.
One thing at the moment, David, that's really obsessing all of us, obviously, if we've got mortgages, is the state of the pound. Yeah. Now, if we had been in Europe, I know the Chancellor said last night it wouldn't have made any good because we're only partly in the European monetary system. Would that have stopped the pound plummeting?
It wouldn't have stopped the pound declining, but we'd have had to take steps earlier on to control it. The whole of the effort of the Europeans would have been behind us in doing it. The government would have had to react earlier, and we'd have stopped the dramatic events which are happening now.
Why
it's
aren't
a marvellous
we in it?
Lesson. It's a marvellous lesson as to how if we started thinking a little bit more intelligently, a little bit more constructively, we could actually make Europe serve British interests. And the only people we're hurting are basically ourselves by this attitude.
Why aren't we in the Euro?
Because we believe that our pound is a petrol currency, because first of all the pound was too high, and then the pound was too low. And the government believes that it's going to compromise their economic policy. Quite frankly, I think that we should have taken the opportunity to get in there, we should take the next opportunity to be in there, and actually realise that the only way we're going to get jobs in Europe, the only way we're going to get investment successful, is actually to turn the European economy into a proper European market, and that is what we're aiming to do. And sovereignty has nothing to do with it.
Kenneth?
Yes, I agree entirely. I agree entirely with that. And I think this is a misconception that we're a petrocurrency because, I mean, economically, it's responsible for about 5% in terms of our national wealth. So it's a rubbishy idea.
Are we in for good, Kenneth, or do you think the move?
Oh, we're in for good, all right. Yes. Oh, you'll never get anyone coming back, going backwards on that. No. I mean, after all, it is essential that the whole world move in this direction eventually. That's
essential. I don't think Val Hansen would agree with that.
Certainly do. Honestly, do you think that we're going to crumble if, say, for instance, we came to the common market tomorrow? Do you think that nobody would talk to us in Europe? Do you honestly think so? It means that we'll be trading throughout the country, throughout the world, rather. We'd still have our sausages, we'd still have our stamps, we'd still have our British passport. What we want is individuality. We don't want to be Europeans because we're not. I don't want us to be Europeans. We're part of a European family, sure. I've got some of my best friends are French. But, you know, we want to be ourselves. And I think the things that make us British are the things that should make us British.
There's a gentleman up there who really wants to say something.
This gentleman over there said about creating jobs. Before very long, we've got enough unemployed in this country now. Before very long, what with the French sending over their golden delicious, I won't allow my wife to buy a thing French.
Yeah, right.
I'm telling you straight. Yeah, yeah. That's a straight.
I'll be honest.
And when you go in Sainsbury's and sees the French milk for about 17p, people are going to buy it because it's cheap, but they don't think about the milk and who's going to be put out of work.
We must put this back.
It is not French milk, it is English milk. It is English milk from English farmers sold cheaper because it's going through the supermarkets. And if you want to keep your doorstep delivery, you buy it off your dairy. That is not French milk. Get your facts right before you shoot your mouth.
There does seem to be a bit of a cord, does there, here?
Where's your
unemployment?
This gentleman up here.
I think all this talk about identity, whether you're English or British, is really rather irrelevant. It's really what the common market does. Now, the problem with the common market is there are 14 million unemployed, a quarter of them are in Britain, but the common market spends nearly all its money on the only 8 million farmers. More and more of the common market's budget is being allocated to agriculture every year. More and more funds are going to put up the grain mountain. Only 8% of Europe's grain mountain could feed Ethiopia for the rest of the year.
We have 15 seconds to the end of the programme. Let me just... Are you English? Are you English? Do you know who your MEP is?
No, Margaret Thatcher.
Margaret Thatcher? No. Do you know who your MEP is?
I know who
do you?
Yes.
Peace Beasley.
Yes? Do you know? Do you know?
Yes.
You do? OK, just quite interesting there. Well, I suppose you can come to say what's in a name. I shall conclude with the good old British expression, that is your lot. Thanks, of course, to all our guests. Literally all of you, you've been wonderful, whether pro or anti-Europe there. We shall reconvene this Thursday when I'll try and hang on to the power of veto. Fat chance of that. A Euro goodbye to you all. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.